saving sinners like me. I say that and can be proud of who I am, but even more proud of who I'm going to be. In a sin-sick, sin-riddled world, the sinful beings have to always cry out to their Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And because of it, he hears each and every one of us. And because of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, I am saved today. I am so happy to be here in front of you today to just bring a word from the Lord. It's not a word that's from Tony. It's a word from the Lord. I'm not even worthy to even carry the words of God. But because of his son, because of his son, I am found worthy and perfect because of his sacrifice. I like to say how happy I am right now to see Elder Callie Williams Jr. I'm always happy to see you, brother. I'm just letting you know they're sitting there looking just like your mother that's sitting next to you. But I am just so happy to see you today. Let us all bow our heads as we approach the throne of grace. Father, I thank you for this opportunity to cry aloud with a small voice, to magnify you with a large voice. We thank you for your son Jesus and his sacrifice. And now we ask that you hide the speaker behind the cross. Let your words come to your people that they may have something to live like, not just today, but for the rest of the time that they are here. We ask this in the worthy name of Jesus. Amen. 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 Now, you just pardon me, I'm going to take my jacket off because I tend to sweat up here, even though it's cool in here today. I'd like to call your attention to our scripture reading for today, which came from the book of Luke, chapter 18, verses 35 to 43. Luke chapter 18, verses 35 to 43 was speaking of a man by the name of Bartimaeus.
Yes, yes.
And our scripture reading pointed out how his persistence to be healed was heard by Jesus Christ, and he was healed.
Amen. Hallelujah.
I would like to now call your attention to the book of Mark, chapter 10, where it has an account, though somewhat differently, of this same occasion where blind Bartimaeus was healed. So let us call our attention to the book of Mark, Mark chapter 10, verses 46 through 52, while we entertain the subject of a tale of two blind men. A tale of two blind men. Mark chapter 10, verses 46 through 52 starts in verse 46. And they came to Jericho, and as he went out of Jericho with his disciples, and a great number of people, blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the highway side begging. And when he had heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, "Thou son of David, have mercy on me." But many charged him that he should hold his peace. But he cried the more a great deal, "Thou son of David, have mercy on me." And Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. And they called the blind man, saying unto him, "Be of good comfort. Rise, he calleth thee." And he, casting away his garment, rose and came to Jesus. And Jesus answered and said unto him, What wilt thou that I should do unto thee? The blind man said unto him, Lord, that I might receive my sight. And Jesus said unto him, Go thy way, thy faith has made thee whole.
Amen.
And immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus in the way. Such a small story about a blind man. Blind Bartimaeus was the son of Timaeus. Now, just by Mark's account of blind Bartimaeus being healed, what we find here is, first of all, that it was mentioned that he was the son of Timaeus. Truth be told, if we lived in those times, what we may have found out was that his name may not have been Bartimaeus, because Bartimaeus simply means the son of Timaeus. The name Timaeus in the Greek meant honor, so his name also meant son of honor. There were very, very many people who had a name that started with the word B-A-R, bar. And all of them were the son of whatever followed that prefix in their name. But we find here that Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, because his name was mentioned in that fact, in that fashion, would have meant that this man was not blind all his life. Because it says that his father was mentioned also in the same text in Mark, was that it was calling attention to the fact that he had a father and his father was a man of honor, thus saying that Bartimaeus may have happened or occurred in his life that caused him to be blind. Even so, all of that withstanding, he was outside the city begging. That in itself brings up another point of that day. Whenever you were outside of a city begging, it was because you were put out of the city. There were always people stricken with leprosy and blindness and all types of diseases that were put out of the city so as to not shame their families. So they were relegated to a life of begging, right outside of the city gates. And blind Bartimaeus was relegated to this same life, begging because he was stricken with blindness. But a man named Jesus. But a man named Jesus came by one day. And blind Bartimaeus had heard of this man. He was not afraid even to call Jesus the son of David. Now, back in that day, if someone was called the son of David, they set themselves up for being stoned. Because the son of David is a reference you should only give to the Messiah. And had it been heard by those who were in charge of the religious sect of that day, he risks certain death for calling Jesus the son of David. But in verse 47, we see that he called aloud, openly, in public, calling Jesus the son of David and asking Jesus to have mercy on him. So what does this tell us about Bartimaeus? It lets us know that he knew who Jesus was. He had either heard of Jesus before in his life, or he may have seen Jesus perform miracles before he himself was stricken with blindness. Even so, Bartimaeus knew who Jesus was. And so when the disciples and the rest of the people tried to calm him down and get him to be quiet, he cried out even louder. Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. And he didn't come to Jesus in any form or fashion, trying to say, here am I, Bartimaeus. I used to be great, but help me out, why don't you? He humbled himself, knowing his condition and knowing who it was he was calling on. He humbled himself and asked Jesus to simply have mercy on him. Much like the person Jesus spoke of, the publican, who simply asked in a prayer, have mercy on me, a sinner. Bartimaeus wasn't trying to cry out like the Pharisees, who trying to be heard for their many, many words, or trying to let everyone know they attended the school of the prophets. You should give me the status that I deserve because I'm bigger than that. Bartimaeus simply cried out to the only man he knew could return his vision, and that was Jesus Christ. And we see, as the story goes, Christ heard his cry, and because of his faith, his sight was restored. Such a small story of a small man who met a great man. But there was another story of a blind man from the Bible. In John chapter 9, we see that there was another blind man. If you go to John chapter 9, starting with verse 1, it says, and as Jesus passed by, he saw a man which was blind from birth. And his disciples asked, saying, masters, who did sin, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Now, back in that day, some things that may have happened to you didn't have to be because of something that you did. Sometimes it's because of what your parents did. We can even remember when it was time for Jesus to be set up for crucifixion. It was asked, who do you want us to release to you? And the crowd cried out for the thief. And then they said, well, what do you want me to do with Jesus of Nazareth? And they all said, crucify him. And they said, let his blood be on us and our children. You gotta be careful what you say. Back in that day, some curses were passed on from parents to their children, which made the disciples believe that this man born from birth was blind because of something his parents did or for something that he did in his life. But Jesus said in verse 3, neither have this man sinned, nor his parents, but that the works of God should be made manifest in him. I must work the works of him that sent me while it is day. The night cometh when no man can work. Verse 5, and as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. Christ said it wasn't that this man or his son or his parents had sinned, but that the works of God might be made manifest in his life. Amen. Jesus always has a plan. If we can remember, when it was time for Lazarus to die, word came to Christ that Lazarus was sick. And Christ did not move right away. So Lazarus died. Most people thought he drug his feet. But but Christ knew just what he wanted to do. Everybody in the world felt that death was the end. But Christ, who was the author of life, knew what death was, just asleep. So because he didn't move right away, he was waiting for the works of God to be made manifest in the life of Lazarus also. Even so, when he even showed up 4 days after the man had been dead, all he had to do was just call his name and tell him to come forth, and the life came right back into Lazarus. So this blind man that was blind from birth was there sitting, waiting for his miracle. Verse 6 says, when he had thus spoken, he spat on the ground and made clay of the spittle. And he anointed the eyes of that blind man with the clay. Verse 7 says, and said unto him, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which by interpretation is sent, S-E-N-T. He went his way, therefore, and washed and came seeing. Now let's hold there. This man, who the blind man did not know, spit on the ground and made clay and anointed his eyes, and then told him to go wash in the pool. It did not say, he said, go wash in the pool and you're going to get your sight back. He said to go wash in the pool. Now, having a little mustard seed of faith would help you to make it to that pool. But I'm just one to think, how would I even head towards that pool when a man who I don't know put dirt on my face and told me to go wash in a pool? Now, unlike blind Bartimaeus, who knew who Jesus was, this man that was blind from birth did not know of Jesus Christ, nor his ministry. He had to accept it by faith. I feel that in his position, he may have tried to do everything and nothing worked. Or maybe he just came to the conclusion that whatever someone gives me that might return my sight, hey, I'm gonna try it. Why not? But it was the fashion and the way in which Jesus anointed his eyes that gave him a little mustard seed of faith that he should go to a pool, which ironically had the name of Sent, S-E-N-T. So he was sent by Jesus to the pool named Sent. And when he washed in this pool, his sight returned. Now, verse 9, let's pick up there. Some said, this is he, and others said, he is like him. But he said, I am he, the man, the blind man that was given his sight. Therefore said they unto him, how were thine eyes opened? The Pharisees are talking here. The blind man answered and said, The Pharisees asked, how were thine eyes open? Verse 11, he answered and said, a man that is called Jesus made clay and anointed mine eyes and said unto me, go to the pool of Siloam and wash. And I went and washed and received sight. Then said they unto him, where is he? And the blind man said, I know not. They brought to the Pharisees him that aforetime was blind. And it was the Sabbath. This is an important verse. Verse 14, and it was the Sabbath day when Jesus made the clay and opened his eyes. Now, this man, blind from birth, given his sight by Jesus, who told him to go to the pool of Siloam and wash, and his sight was returned. Now, he's having an ordinance with the Pharisees. And the Pharisees of that day, they just wanted to get to the root of this guy who was working on Sabbath. And so he was brought before the Seventh-day Adventists. I mean, the Pharisees. So he was brought before the Pharisees. And they said that it was the Sabbath day. And again, the Pharisees also asked him how he had received the sight. And he said unto them, he put clay on my eyes, and I washed, and I see. Now, this man is getting tired of explaining this. Therefore, some of the Pharisees said that this man is not of God, because he keepeth not the Sabbath day. Others said, how can a man that is a sinner do such miracles? And there was division amongst all of them. Now, some of the Adventists said, some of the Pharisees said, that how can this man perform miracles like this on the Sabbath day? Or, in other words, how can this sinner who's working on the Sabbath give you back your sight? Now, pay attention here. This is very, very important. They said unto the blind man again, what sayest thou of him, he that hath opened thine eyes? He said, he is a prophet. The blind man didn't know who Jesus was. I've just gotten my sight back, so he must be a prophet. But the Jews did not believe concerning him that he had been blind and received his sight until they called his parents in. So they can't believe him, so they called his parents. And they asked them, saying, is your son, who ye say was born blind, how then does he now see? And his parents answered them, said, we know not that this is our son and that he was blind. But what means he now seeth? Oh, no, they said, we do know that this is our son. But what means that he now seeth, we know not. Or who have opened his eyes, we know not. He is of age, go ask him. Now, the reason his parents took that position is because if their son is talking about Jesus the way they are, we're going to let this decision from the Adventists, the Pharisees, we're going to let this decision from the Pharisees fall on your head, not ours. So they said, he is of age, go ask him. So these words spake his parents because they feared the Jews. For the Jews had agreed already that if any man did confess that he was Christ, he would be put out of the synagogue. And by that, they mean put out the synagogue and they would have a rock concert. What you mean? They would stone him. Blasphemy was a number one crime in those days. So therefore, said his parents, he is of age, ask him. So then again, they called the man back in again. Now I told you, this blind man is getting tired of answering the same question. They called him back in again and said unto him, give God the praise. We know that this man is a sinner. And he answered and said, oh, this is good. Verse 25. Now, the Pharisees were trying to be somewhat trickery. They want to praise God with them. They said, praise be to God. We know that this man that healed you is a sinner. But the blind man answered and said, whether he be a sinner or no, all I know is one thing. I know that whereas I was blind, but now I see. So I don't care if he was a sinner or whatever he was. I know that from birth, I haven't seen a thing. But this man put clay on my eyes. I went and watched, and now I see. So he can be a sinner to you or whatever. All I know is that I can see. And then they said to him again, what did he to thee who opened your eyes? And he answered to them, I have told you already. I told you this man is getting tired of this. I have told you already, and you did not hear me? Wherefore would ye hear it again? Will you be disciples of his? So if I tell you one more time, are you going to become his disciples also? Of course not. But then the Pharisees, they reviled him. And they said that thou art his disciple. But we are Moses' disciples. We know that God spake unto Moses, as for this fellow you're talking about, we know not from whence he is. And the man answered them and said unto them, why wherein is a marvelous thing that ye know not from whence he is? Because yet he has opened mine eyes. Now, you may not know where he is, but I know wherever he is, he's the one that gave me my sight. I don't like it when someone does something good for you and you go to someone else and they talk evil of the person who did something good for you. Let me back that up and help you out. Okay? My car wasn't running because I needed a battery. And someone comes by and say, here, I just went to Advance Auto and bought you this new battery. That person that bought you your new battery was known as a nefarious person, okay? A person who people didn't never go to for anything because he was looked at as being mean and never would do anything like that. But he had a battery, he gave it to you. Then you were happy because now your car runs. Now you say to everyone, okay, my car runs now because Jake down the street gave me a battery. Now he says, you shouldn't have took that battery from him. Don't you know what he do for a living? Are you following me? Okay? I don't care what Jake does for a living. All I know is that my car didn't run. He gave me a battery, and now my car runs. So don't come to me saying, why are you praising this sinner who gave you sight? All I know, you can call him a sinner all you want. I was blind, now I see, and it's because of him. Happens all the time in this life. Don't go putting your mouth on my miracle. I don't care where it came from. In your sight, because I know in my sight, it came from God. So you can talk all you want by the means that I am able to see this day. Continuing on with the story. Since the world began, was it not heard that any man opened the eyes of one that was born blind? Of course not. If this man were not of God, he could do nothing. But back that up again. And this is still the blind man talking. Since the world began, was it not heard that any man opened the eyes of one that was born blind? If this man were not of God, he could do nothing. They answered and said unto him, thou wast altogether born in sins, and dost thou now teach us? And they cast him out of the synagogue. We're tired of hearing you talk about this Jesus guy. Get out of here. Jesus heard that they had cast him out, and when he had found the man, he said unto him, Dost thou believe on the Son of God? And the man answered and said, Who is he, Lord, that I might believe in him? And Jesus said unto him, Thou hast both seen him, and it is he that talketh to thee now. And he said, Lord, I believe. And he worshiped him, just like blind Bartimaeus once he gained his sight. Amen. Once he found that his sight came from Jesus, he worshiped him. And Jesus said, For judgment I am come into this world, that they which see not might see, and they which see might be made blind. I'm going to read that again because I kind of stumbled a little bit. Jesus said, For judgment I am coming to this world, that they which see not might see, and they that which see might be made blind. Tell you what that means because I like this, okay? Because a lot of bad things happen to you once you start believing in God and letting people know you a Christian. On my job, everyone knows that I am a Christian. I used to explain it like this. Everyone knows on my job that I profess to be a Christian. Professing is not what I'm doing anymore. Right. I speak boldly of my master. Amen. As soon as someone asks me, because I can't tell them unless they ask me. They say they got this separation of church and state thing. Anyway, I can't go preaching on the job unless someone asks me. And I love it when they ask me. Let me say that again. I love it when they ask me, Are you a Christian? Yes, I'm a Christian. I believe wholeheartedly in Jesus Christ, and he is my Savior. I am a Christian, and today I'm saved. So I love it when they ask me. This blind man and blind Bartimaeus, once they were given their sight back, they didn't stop praising the name of God. Let me tell you, praising the name of God. The man that was born blind had a more noteworthy praise because he said to the Pharisees who could like that tell him that you're going to be stoned. He was not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Isn't that what Paul said? Said, all I know is that I was blind and now I see. So you can call him a sinner all you want. The man must be a prophet or something else because I have been blind all my life and now I see. But the similarities between blind Bartimaeus and the man that was blind before birth, from his birth, is this. Once they met a man named Jesus. Once they met a man named Jesus and he restored their sight, they praised him for the rest of their lives. This is what we can take an example from. When Jesus does something for you, you can't keep quiet. You may try, but you can't keep quiet. Their similarities was that they both gave praise. Their differences were that Bartimaeus knew who Jesus was. The man that was blind from birth did not know of Jesus. Another similarity is they both had that much faith. Can't even see that. They both had a little bit of faith, and that little bit of faith gave them a whole lot of healing. That little bit of faith gave them a whole lot of healing. The man that was blind from his birth, once Christ heard that he was put outside of the synagogue, Jesus went and found the man and asked him, who was it that healed him? And the man said he did not know because he did not know Christ. Amen. But once Christ revealed himself to the man, he praise the name of he who gave him his healing. Now, if we remember the differences between their healing, all Christ did for blind Bartimaeus is told him that go your way, your sight is given to you, and his sight was returned. But he had to do a few things for the man that was blind from birth. He had to take clay and anoint it, put it on his eyes, and tell him to go wash in a pool. The name of the pool was sent. Now, there was no power in that pool. People had washed in that pool all day, came out looking the same. Back in that day, whenever you went to a pool, sometimes people used the pool to wash their horses and their camels. So sometimes the pool, even though it was used to clean you, it was still dirty. There was no power in the pool. He was sent to the pool called Sin. Was sent to the pool by someone who told him to go wash. And he had faith to believe that once he was sent there, that he would get his sight back. Now, here is the key that you should take home with. He who sent him to sin was sent himself to save. I'm going to say that again a few times because I want you to take that home with me. He who sent him to sin was sent himself to save. Jesus Christ, who anointed his eyes and sent him to the pool of Siloam, sent, was sent by his Father down here to save each and every one of us.
Amen.
So that faith that the blind man had came from on high.
Amen.
That once his eyes were anointed and he went and washed, that he would receive his sight.
Amen.
Both stories have differences and similarities, but both blind men were joyful after their healing. They both thanked and praised and worshiped Christ for the rest of their lives.
Amen.
Now, they didn't thank him with that. Oh, I'm glad it's Sabbath. Happy Sabbath, everyone. God bless you. That kind of praise. No, they didn't have that. They had that radical, get up out of your seat, shout and show some sign. Holy Ghost filled. I'm glad God saved me. Magnificent, overwhelming, abundant, crazy like praise. They had that praise that makes people look at you and think something wrong with you. Because sometimes when things happen at my job, I will stop and I'll say, praise the Lord. And I don't care if they hear me then. Let's say, because all of my help don't come from who signed my check at work. Woo! My help comes from the Lord. So when things come, and something happened last week, my wife will tell you, we had an audit, and the audit almost went bad. We were 2 percentage points off, just 2 percentage points off of a good grade. That man, the auditors told my supervisor's boss, we're gonna go check one thing at his building. If it's right, you'll get your 2 percentage points. If it isn't, you're losing 2 more. I knew nothing of this. Show you how God worked. They showed up at my building. I called my wife because my supervisor said, Tony, go outside. And I knew these were the auditors. I said, oh no, they have found something. Said, Tony, go outside. I went outside, called my wife, pray for me. Real hard. I said, because the auditors are here and I don't know what it is that they have found. About 10 minutes, that's all it took. They come back in, I'm still talking to my wife. I said, look, I got to go now. I went back inside. And they said, Mr. Brown, these lockers that are filled with emergency supplies for if we have a hurricane, have you checked them? I said, well, yes, I did. And they said, oh, okay. Then why isn't the seal broken? I said, because by instruction, Lord, thank you. By instruction. a hurricane was imminent, called Irma, I opened that locker, inventoried it, checked it, and resealed it. They say, now, be careful answering this question. Did you sign the inventory paper? I say, yes. They say, okay, open the locker now and show it to us. I opened the locker, broke the seal, got the paper. That's my signature. That's the date I did it. And they say, no one at any of our facilities have ever paid attention to opening these lockers as instructed. So they felt that when they went to his building, the same thing would occur. But here we go. Praise be to God. I put my foot down. Praise be to God that when I read that email that a hurricane is imminent, I went to my disaster relief locker, broke the seal, opened it, counted everything, took the batteries out, put them in flashlight, make sure the flashlights work, put them back in the locker, inventoried everything, signed the sheet, dated it, put it in the locker, sealed it back up. When they came and signed it, my boss was nervous. And he said, you were nervous too. I said, I wasn't nervous because of you. I say, because regardless of what happens here, God still has me. And even if something was wrong and I would have lost my job here, he would have gave me another one. So I won't worry about you. But praise be to God. We got the 2 percentage points. Put Tony up for employee of the quarter. What God do can't no man change. When everything seemed the darkest, he shows up on time. And you don't even have to be blind to see that. God has always been working in the background. Whenever your bills, I'm gonna tell you about this. Whenever your bills are due and you ain't got enough money and you don't know what to do, you just gotta remember who owns the cattle on 1,000 hills and that he'll always show up on time. And you ain't got to be blind to see that. Whenever you strive to do what God says, keep the 2 commandments, love God, love your neighbor as yourself. But instead, people revile you and persecute you and say all manner of evil against you for his sake. But hey, rejoice and be exceedingly glad, because so persecuted they the prophets that were before you. God is still with you. He's not against you. And you don't have to be blind to see that. Whenever you're hungry, ain't got enough to eat, and like that widow that only had enough meal and a little curse of oil, made something for the prophet of God first, and because she was faithful to God, the meal didn't run out and the oil multiplied, because God always takes care of those who are faithful to him. So if you ain't got enough to eat, David said, I was young, but now I'm old, but I ain't never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging for bread. And you know what? You ain't gotta be blind to see that. Whenever God tells you something, it's the truth. All your help comes from the Lord. And you know, whenever I get up, I always try to just get up, speak up, and then shut up. I brought you a message today that 2 blind men were healed because they had that much faith, just that much faith. And if you got that much faith, God can do a lot for you. You ain't got to be blind to see that. Just try them. Try them. I tried them.
Everything I have now, it ain't a lie. I don't never brag. I'm just happy and content with what I got. Because I called on the Lord one day and I said, I ain't got to have a lot. Just give me enough to get home. And he blesses me. 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 I can keep doing this. It ain't no broken record. Every day I get up, his mercies are brand new for me. Oh, over again. And I don't have to be blind to see that. This one is just for all of you. If you ain't got that kind of relationship with the Master, you need to get it. And you need to get it quick. My mother always told me, you gonna learn to give praise to the God who made you. And you gonna learn it quick. Because ain't nobody, nobody in this world gonna take care of you like God. Young people, I'm telling you, when you're young, you think you got forever to get this. But you better get it quick. No one's gonna take care of you like God. He has all power in his hands. You ain't gotta be blind to see that. Anything you ask him for, he can give it to you. Won't he give it to your elder? Won't he give it to you, people? Anything that you ask in his name, he'll give it to you. So why don't you simply just give him your life? If you have not given Christ your life, just stand now and just come down that aisle and make that bold statement. That bold statement to let the world know God is the head of your life. If you need a family to join, it's right here for you. That's the hard part. The easy part is you'll be praising him like those two blind men for the rest of your life. And you'll get to a place where it's comfortable for you. I used to be ashamed saying that I believed in God and that I was a Christian. But now I am happy. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Because it's the power to all that believe. All that believe. And you can call on that power anytime. Anytime. He even dresses it up sometimes in packages you don't see. I get discouraged, go home, and have to hold my wife. I just don't know how I'm going to make it this time. And the next day at work, my breakthrough happens. And then I tell you, he showed up again. And I have a corner. I like saying this. I have a corner in my warehouse. That's my shouting corner. When miracles occur for me during my work day, I get happy, folk. And so I'll leave everybody after everyone's through talking. And I go to my shouting corner. And I get to that corner and say, praise be to God. Thank you for helping a sinner like me. I'm not worthy, but you helped me anyway. When I call on your name, here it is, you heard it a lot of times. You may not come when I want you, but you're right on time. I praise him just like those blind men. And I don't have to be blind to see it. Let us all stand. Father, we thank you for your son, Jesus Christ, that died on that old rugged cross, that all of us may have a right through the tree of life. And we don't have to be blind to see that. Father, we thank you for your healing. Your healing for this church. Your healing for each and every one of us. Help us to not be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let us accept that power that Paul preached about, that we will go on and speak boldly, proclaiming the name of Jesus Christ. And now we thank you for all that we are going to ask for. We thank you in advance. We praise your name. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name.